You moved in power. Good morning. Welcome to Skokie Valley. We are so glad that you're here this morning. Will you stand to your feet and let's just praise and worship the Lord together. Whoa, whoa.
I believe you are. day with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I'm here with you. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on
we
seated.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, welcome. Oh, there we go. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Skokie Valley this morning. It's just such a privilege to get to worship God, to declare together that Jesus is the Messiah, that he is Lord of all, and all of our hope is in him. And so thank you for being here this morning. Congrats to those in the sanctuary. You made it here even with the hour difference of sleep. I admit it, I wanted to come at the 11 o'clock service today, but I couldn't. But thank you for being here. Those online, good job waking up and joining us as well. We're so thankful you're with us. If you happen to be joining us for maybe the first time, a special welcome to you. We would love to know you're here. Those online, those in the sanctuary, we'd love the chance to connect, answer any questions you have. There's cards in the seat pocket in front of you here in the sanctuary or in the YouTube description over there for those online. Please just take a moment even right now and fill that out. And if you're here in the sanctuary, you could take it to the welcome desk out the doors to your left, the welcome desk over there on your way out. Our bulletins that hopefully you grabbed this morning on your way in have most of the things we have for us this morning. But a couple things that I want to highlight, I should say, from that. The first being that the college students that are back for spring break, we would love to get a chance to connect with you this week. We have a game night this Friday at 7 p.m. at my house. If you need my address, come find me afterwards, or otherwise it's in the GroupMe. If you're not part of the GroupMe and you're a college-age student, come find me afterwards and we'll get you a part of that real quick. You can also find Matt Cassio or Roy Casis as well. They'll get you on there. But we'd love for you to come out. We're going to have a great time with some snacks, games. So this Friday, 7 p.m., my house. Look forward to seeing you there. Now, you college students, cover your ears real quick. The rest of the church, we want to show love to our college students, so we're going to put together care packages to send to those college students back at school, not when they're here at spring break, but in weeks to come. So this week and next week, we're opening the opportunity, if you'd like to give, either with the offering envelopes in front of you or online. We're going to then give some gift cards and some other notes of encouragement to those college students, mailing them out in the coming weeks. So again, if you're interested in that, the next couple weeks we'll collect money. We'd love for you to be able to support the college kids with that. For the men in the room, coming up here in a few weeks, the 1st of April, we are going to have a Final Four March Madness event here at the church down in the gym. We'll watch whichever the game is in the evening. We don't know who's going to make it yet. I know Pastor Alex is rooting for his Kansas Jayhawks. So you could either root for him or against him, depending on where your allegiances lie when it comes to college basketball. But regardless of who you root for, I hope all the men in the congregation come on out. We'll give you the times once we know the actual time of the game, but plan somewhere in the 5 p.m. neighborhood of it starting, going until around 8:30. We'll provide burgers, hot dogs. We'd love for you to bring a side or snack to share. And then we'll have some basketball games, three-point contest, knockout. If you want to play some little scrimmage, you could totally come ready, as prepared as you want to, for as much basketball as you want to on the other half of the gym. It'll be a lot of fun. We do ask that you let us know you're coming so we know about the food. You could go to skokievalley.org/events, the website page that we have there for all of our registrations, and click that RSVP button to send us an email and let us know you're coming. Two other events that we need some signups for involving the Holy Week coming up in the week after that. We have Easter lilies we need people to sign up for. If you'd like to purchase a lily in honor or in memory of a loved one to help decorate the stage on Easter Sunday, you could do so, again, skokievalley.org/events, or there's a table out to the right in front of the TV that has announcements rolling on it over there. You could sign up in person today as well. And that goes for the Last Supper as well. We're doing a Reflections on the Last Supper, the Thursday of Holy Week there, and we need to know who's coming. It is limited to the amount of people we can have that can fit in the gym. It's going to be a special time led by Reverend Dr. Paul Wright, and so make sure you let us know you're coming. Again, skokievalley.org/events, or you could also register for that at the table over there on the right as well. With that, I'll invite up Gail.
Good morning, Skokie Valley. It's really good to see everybody here today. One of the things about daylight savings time is, no matter how it looks here in Chicago, we know that spring's coming. So change is ahead. There's a lot of different ways to give here at Skokie Valley. We have, you can give the good old-fashioned way, use a check and put it in the envelope in the seat pocket in front of you. There are boxes in the back in the narthex where you can drop those off. You can give online, or you can use the QR code in front of your seat. And I want to tell you a little bit about where these funds go. One of the places it goes is to our global missions, which I'm part of. Pastor Tim, you're going to be sorry you gave me the mic. Anyway, we have the privilege of stewarding about 10% of the church budget. And this goes to individuals who are serving globally. And a large portion of those people are reaching the unreached. Not only are we supporting people who live abroad, but we're supporting people who live in the U.S. as well. Did you know our own Hoda Gurgis is going to Guatemala with crew? Yes. Amen. We had the privilege just this week of learning about her trip. So yes, Skokie Valley is going to be supporting Hoda, on her trip to Guatemala. So we're going to support her financially, but we also are going to support her in prayer. One of our other missionaries that we support, well, wait a minute, I'm going to back up. We have, we're going to be meeting the president of Arab Baptist Theological Seminary later this month. This is a major big deal because this seminary in Beirut reaches across the Middle East and through Africa. They are training their students to go back into dangerous areas. They're going back to their countries, their cities, their neighborhoods, their families, where they're going to be sharing the gospel, training others to be disciples of Jesus, and quite frankly, they can be putting their lives at risk. So come on out March 26th, and if you come to the second service, we're going to have a luncheon after church, and it's going to be a time of food, fun, fellowship, and you're actually going to have a chance to ask questions to hear more about the ministry there in Beirut and Lebanon. We have a special video greeting from one of our other missionaries, Tim Beavis. Tim is well known to all of us. He serves with Carey International, and he is focusing on pastoral training. So he's going abroad and spending his time teaching other pastors how to go and reach their congregation, teaching them how to prepare and unleash their friends, their neighbors, their church members to share the gospel of Christ. Let's hear from Tim.
Hello to everyone at Skokie Valley. This is Tim Beavis serving with Carey International Pastoral Training. Right now I am in Uganda as a part of our work of training and equipping leaders for the global church. I want to say thank you once again for your prayers for us and your continuing generosity in supporting the work that we do. And here in the next moment or so, I want to introduce you to one of the pastors that we're training during our time here as he shares with you just a brief testimony of how the equipping is impacting him personally and how he's planning to use it in the ministry that that the Lord has called him to. Thank you so much.
Praise the Lord. My name is Juanuka Achilles from Cornerstone City Church in Entebbe. I am grateful for Carey International, the university where with Dr. Tim. It's a blessing. It's an honor to be trained under his, you know, his training. This time we are handling the, we have been going through the lesson that teaches us about preaching, the expository preaching, and I have come to understand that it is so helpful, it is so good, and the biblical leadership course, it is also helping us. We are seeing new things, probably that we have not been seeing before, and we are being equipped to become effective, even in the ministry that God has called us for. So we are so grateful. Myself, I'm grateful, and I'm intentional. I am intentional in taking this course, these courses, not just to take and keep the knowledge, but to get the knowledge that I use and apply even in the ministry. Yeah, so I'm blessed. Amen. In the name of Jesus.
Would you bow your heads in prayer with me? Oh, Father God, we are so grateful to be here this morning. Father, I thank you for Skokie Valley. I thank you for the generosity of this church and their love for your people, their love for our missionaries, and Lord, I thank you for their support. Father, I pray for the men and women who are in pastoral training, Lord. I ask that you make learning easy. I pray that communication be clear and the concepts be understood so that your words can spread. Father, I pray for our pastor, our brother serving in Pakistan, who we know by the pseudonym of Pastor Ben Luke, and Lord, I ask that you heal his body as he was beaten and robbed this week, Lord. I pray that everything that was taken be returned. And, Lord, we pray for his healing, and we ask that he be able to go back to your work, strong and courageous, unafraid, knowing that you are with him. Lord, I ask that you be with our service. I pray for our hearts. Lord, I pray that they be turned toward you so that everything that is said touch us, and Lord, that we be able to apply it to our lives and share it with others. In Jesus' name.
Will you stand once again as we continue to worship this morning? Father, we trust you this morning. we give you all the glory and all the praise that you so richly deserve. Lord, we thank you for the gift of your Son, that you sent him on the cross to die for our sins. Lord, as we come upon this season of Easter and preparing our hearts, Lord, we just ask that you would help us to focus on this amazing gift and your blessings that you give to us each and every day. Lord, we ask a special blessing upon Pastor Tim as he brings your word to us this morning, that you would just open our hearts and our ears to hear what you want us to hear this morning. We ask all of these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
Just want to, I want to acknowledge as we get started this morning, almost 65 women were here yesterday for the prayer breakfast. So appreciate the fact that they permeated the place with prayer. Thank you, ladies, for your ministry yesterday. Men, we have some catching up to do, right? I love the fact that our women are leading the way in that, and how important it is to be prayerful all the time. Proverbs chapter 26, if you have your Bible, open up to Proverbs chapter 26. In May 1709, English playwright Susanna Centlivre premiered a comedy called The Busybody at the Drury Lane Theatre in London. In fact, she was the most famous English playwright of the 18th century. The play, The Busybody, addressed the power of parents to determine who their children could or should marry. Miranda loves George, but her guardian has other plans. Isabinda loves Charles, but her father wants her to marry a Spanish gentleman. Anyways, weaved throughout the plot is a character named Marplot. Marplot, which literally means the one who destroys or messes up the story. This guy's name is Marplot, and he's a busybody. A busybody who meddles in the romantic affairs of the other characters. Marplot, the busybody, is driven by curiosity, for which he ends up beaten, exploited, disappointed, marginalized, left alone. The play was so well received, in fact, she came out with a sequel about Marplot. Anyways, the name Marplot, which again means somebody who messes up something good, became synonymous with a busybody. It became synonymous with a busybody. A busybody, a marplot, is someone who unnecessarily interferes in the affairs of another person. That's what a busybody is. Wisdom. That's what we're talking about in this series. Wisdom is, hopefully you know this by now, the practical expression of the fear of God in everyday life. Part of wisdom is learning how to deal with difficult people, people problems. Wise people know how to live amidst complex people issues, circumstances. With people come problems. Of course, we know this. In our text this morning, again, Proverbs chapter 26, verses 17 through 22, offers a strategy for dealing with people problems, with people problems. Now, what do we mean by people problems? Because I just want to run through a quick list here, just to kind of remind you what a people problem might be, and hopefully this helps you to see that this doesn't land too far from your life. What are some of the people problems that we might keep in mind here? Mental health, anxiety, depression, or things even more severe. Physical health, things like weight issues, illness, disease, finances, too little, too much, relationships, broken marriages, broken families, broken friendships, work and career, coworkers, pressures, overworked, underlooked, overlooked, injustice, the effects of race, gender, education, environment, status. Are we touching home with anybody here this morning? Failures, setbacks, discouragement, shame from having done it wrong. Spiritual, lack of peace, confidence, security, faith. Those are all people problems. Anybody know anybody with people problems? Anybody here have people problems? I think all of us can relate to something in that list. So how do we deal wisely with people problems? How do we deal wisely with other people's problems? What is reasonable for us to expect from other people as they deal with our problems, people problems? Again, wisdom is seeking to take the timeless truths of God, the doctrines, the propositions, the creeds, and apply them very specifically to the way that we live our lives, especially those complex situations and those complex people. Wisdom prescribes extreme care in dealing with other people's stuff. Again, Proverbs chapter 26, hopefully by now you're there. Proverbs 26, we started with this last week, Proverbs 26, 1 through 12. We skipped over a few verses, if you've noticed. We've skipped over 13 through 17 because they deal with the sluggard, which Pastor Alex addressed a few weeks ago. So we're going to skip over that, and we're going to look here at 17 through 22 and the issue of the busybody. How do we deal wisely with other people's problems? This morning's sermon is structured around three don'ts. I remember when I took homiletics, that's the class that they call preaching. When I took homiletics at Moody, one of the things that they said was, don't ever structure your points around things that people shouldn't do. Well, that's what I'm doing this morning. So don't tell Dr. Perry that I'm doing this. He's still down there as the provost. Anyways, three don'ts for dealing with people problems. Number one, don't meddle in other people's problems. Don't meddle in other people's problems. I love the imagery of verse 17. Whoever meddles in a quarrel not his own is like one who takes a passing dog by the ears. Anybody have a big dog here? Sherry does not have a big dog. Sherry has like a 3-pound dog. And I don't have a big dog. Anybody have a big dog? Come on, raise your hand if you got a big dog. Somebody's got a 50-pounder. All right, we got one in the back. Big dogs. Imagine grabbing a dog by the ear. What is the dog going to do? Does a dog like that? I mean, you can pull on a dog's tail, at least you're behind it, but when you grab a dog by the ear, what is it? Its face is right there. Anyways, the structure of this proverb, if you see it there on the screen, the structure of this proverb is striking. This is called emblematic parallelism. Two lines of poetry in which one line is figurative and the other line is more literal, and the two of them taken together give us meaning, emblematic parallelism. So let's look one at a time here at the figurative and then the literal. Figurative, grabbing the ear of a dog that is passing by. Now, in our culture, we like dogs. I mean, we treat dogs like they're humans. You know, we allow them to have all sorts of privileges in our homes. In the ancient world, not so much. A dog was sort of the epitome of a despised creature. The ear of a dog is probably one of its most sensitive parts. And the ear is right by the mouth. If you pull the tail, at least you can run. But if you grab the ear, what's going to happen? That dog is going to instinctively jerk its head and take a bite out of your hand. That's the picture of, more literally, meddling in another person's business. The wise person will walk away from a dispute in which he or she has no interest. Why? Because it's in your best interest to walk away. Not in their best interest. That's not what this proverb is talking about. It's in your best interest to walk away from a dispute that is not your own. Don't get involved in problems that don't concern you. Have respect for yourself. Don't get involved in problems that don't concern you. Don't you have enough problems of your own? Anyways, there's a proverb in English, don't poke the bear. It's a little idiomatic expression, don't poke the bear. You know what that means? Don't get caught up in someone else's problems unless you're ready for those problems to become your problems. And by the way, that's an important qualifier. Don't get caught up in somebody else's problems unless you're ready for those person's problems to become your own problems. Maybe you are ready for that. But if you're not, certainly don't poke the bear. Early in my ministry in Rwanda, one of my colleagues was falsely accused, and some of you who knew us at the time, you'll remember Kata Birora. Some of you remember that name because you prayed for him here and actually helped out so much with his wife whenever he was put in prison. Anyways, our colleague was accused of genocide crimes, and he was put in prison. He was put in prison for 20 years, and I felt like it was unjust. I felt like it was unfair because after he was put in prison, a few people used the opportunity, the accusers used the opportunity to send a delegation to my office to request extortion. They said, if you give X amount of money, in fact, it was like, if you give this many cows and this many suits, is all, you know, symbolic of money. If you give a certain amount of money today, your guy will walk out of prison before the sun goes down. And they said that they represented the judges. How about that for an unjust situation, right? Give us this much money, your guy will walk free today. Well, I was young and inexperienced, simple, in the language of Proverbs, simple. Simple is not a criticism, it's a reality, as we've said before. So I went to visit my colleague in jail. I wanted to show support. I went and I poked the bear, so to speak. The jail was a little holding pen on the side of the road in a southern province, a little town called Nyamata, which means the city of milk. I went to the holding pen there, and it was just a small wooden fence that kept these prisoners from running free. But I mean, why in the world would they want to run free with all sorts of like Kalashnikovs pointed at them pretty much all day? A Kalashnikov is an AK-47. Anyway, so there he was, and I'm visiting my friend, my coworker, who's just been caught 20 years in prison. And again, I had poked the bear. The mayor of the town. This is one of the larger cities in Rwanda. The mayor of the town heard that I was there. He was twice my age, and he left his office. This is the only time I ever experienced physical violence myself in Rwanda. Rwandans, they just don't do that publicly. Anyways, the mayor of the town came out of his office. He came across town. He found me there at this little prison, and he pinned me up against the car, and he said to me, if you're the friend of a slaughterer, then you're a slaughterer yourself. I'd poked the bear. I got involved. And it had implications and repercussions in my life. Here's the point. If you meddle with other people's problems, there's the high likelihood that you're going to get hurt in the process. If you meddle, you're probably going to get hurt. So weigh out the situation. Weigh out what's in front of you and ask yourself a few questions to know whether or not you ought to get involved. These are important questions. I hope you'll take time to reflect on these, as of course you're surrounded by people with problems, right? But ask yourself a few questions. Number one, is my involvement helpful? Is my involvement helpful? Is it because I have something that I can genuinely offer that situation to help? Is my involvement helpful, or is it because I want to feel needed? That's the wrong motivation. Is my involvement helpful? And then secondly, is my involvement virtuous? Now, what I mean by that is virtue, as we might find here in the book of Proverbs, as we saw in the very first chapter. Am I able to reflect in my involvement righteousness, justice, and integrity? Those are those three virtues that wisdom seeks to demonstrate in even the most complex circumstances. In my involvement, assuming that it's helpful, am I able to be virtuous? Righteousness, justice, and integrity. Or is my involvement eliciting a side of me that delights in a mess? I don't know what it is about people, but there is a side of us that delights in other people's stuff. Is my involvement eliciting a side of me that delights in a mess, takes a side, or validates something broken inside of me? Take these questions seriously, because if you're going to poke the bear is going to turn the bear's head and fix its eyes directly on you. That's the wisdom of this proverb. You'd better have more than just the attitude of the need to feel special or powerful if you know that the bear is going to turn its head and you're going to get hurt. Again, don't hear me wrong. I'm not saying don't get involved. But know that by getting involved in other people's problems, it is in some way going to cost you something. How do we deal with other people's problems? Well, first, don't meddle in other people's problems, because it's going to come back to hurt you as well. Secondly, don't trifle with other people's problems. Now, we're going to kind of nuance the difference between meddling and trifling, because they are different words. Don't trifle with other people's problems. Here we're looking at verses 18 and 19. And again, beautiful, stunning imagery. These next two verses together form a couplet. The 18 and 19 together form like a proverb. Verse 18, like a man who throws firebrands. Imagine this. I really wrestled with trying to understand how some of these things are thrown. Like a madman who throws firebrands. Can you see, like, throwing fire through the air? A madman who throws arrows. Okay, we can imagine, you know, shooting arrows, crazy. A man who throws death. A madman who throws death is a little bit harder to wrap my mind around. But I think the imagery is building in intensity. Verse 19, is the man who deceives his neighbor and says, for years I've heard, I was only joking. So that's how I'm going to say it this morning. I was only joking. So there's a figurative side. This is emblematic parallelism again. There's a figurative side, then there's a literal side. Figuratively, we have a madman throwing firebrands, arrows, and death. Now, the word translated madman here in our text has the idea of a person whose words and behaviors are startlingly out of place because he or she is out of his or her right mind. If we want a biblical example of this, I think of 1 Samuel chapter 21, when David fled from King Saul into the land of Gath, when he realized that he was actually in the territory of the enemy of Israel, and he realized he wasn't safe. Do you remember what he did? We've been talking about this a little bit on Wednesdays during our mental health and spirituality course with Dr. Calvin. Remember what David did? He pretended to be insane. He started scraping at the doors, and spittle, that's the biblical word, spittle was running down his beard. It's kind of a gross scene. Anyways, that's the picture of a madman. Now, maintain in your mind the image of a madman, then place into the madman, not the one who's playing around as a madman like David was, because David, of course, was in his right mind. It was a part of a strategy. Somebody who's legitimately mad, place into that person's hands deadly weaponry, flaming darts, deadly arrows. That's the picture of, more literally, trifling with another person's problems, trifling with another person's problems, trifling, making light of another person's problems. Now, the verse says, is the man who deceives, this is again verse 19, is the man who deceives his neighbor. Now, the word translated deception has less to do with lying. We're going to talk about the liar, Lord willing, next week. The word translated as deception has less to do with lying, more to do with treachery, mischievous motives. This person makes his or her comments from what appears to be genuine concern, gains a hearing, and then just walks away, pretends to be concerned. Again, we've got an idiom for this. In English, don't stir the pot, right? It's a good English idiom, don't stir the pot. Imagine having cooked a large pot of beef stew. Sounds good. The ingredients have settled to the bottom. The meat, the carrots, the potatoes, the tomatoes, everything has settled to the bottom of the pot. Then along comes a big wooden spoon. Somebody reaches in and unnecessarily stirs up the ingredients. Ingredients start to surface. Things leave the bottom of the pot. Pot stirrers do not rectify real problems. Pot stirrers instigate unnecessary problems. And then they walk away. I was only joking. Or I'm not really serious. I wasn't really intending to get involved. The people, so who gets hurt whenever the stirrer stirs the pot? Who gets hurt? It's not the stirrer, it's the people who are stuck in that situation. The people whose lives have been churned up. So whereas the earlier proverb, it's the person who gets involved who's potentially hurt, here in this second set of verses, verses 18 and 19, it's the people in the problem who get hurt. So again, a few questions to ask yourself as you contemplate getting involved with people in their people problems. Again, hear me clearly this morning. I'm not saying don't get involved. I'm saying know what's going on when you do. First, is my involvement sincere? I know that when I stir the pot, I'm going to mix things up and cause some discomfort. With every question I ask, I'm stirring the pot and I'm going to mix things up. Am I prepared? Is that my intent? Is my goal to stir things up for that person and then just walk away insincerely? Is my involvement sincere? What inside of me wants to do that? Is it my love and genuine concern? If it is, hey, stir the pot. Or is it my need to be needed or my need to be seen? Perhaps you'll know the answer to the question when you remember or consider the answer to the next question. Is my involvement sustained? You see, pot stirrers, they stir the pot and then they walk away. Remember, the person who trifles, stirs the pot, walks away. If they're there to help, they're going to stay. So again, how do we deal with people's problems? Number one, don't meddle with other people's problems because you're going to get hurt. Number two, don't trifle with people's problems because they're going to get hurt. And finally, number three, don't blab about other people's problems. There's a very deep word, blab. I felt like that was a cheap word. It feels a little bit informal, but it totally fits. To blab means to talk idly or foolishly, to not control your tongue. Three verses encourage us not to blab about other people's problems. Blab. Isn't that a great word? Blah, 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 blah. Just say it. It feels good. Blah, 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 blah. Verse 20. Again, we have the figurative and literal all the way through this emblematic parallelism. Verse 20. For lack of wood, the fire goes out, and where there is no whisperer, quarreling ceases. Figuratively, no wood means no fire. No wood, no fire. Wood keeps the fire going. When the wood runs out, the fire dies out. Literally, no gossip means no quarreling. Where there is no gossip, the conflict slows down. Inflammatory speech keeps a fire going. Get the instigator to stop whispering and the problem will calm down. Imagine how many conflicts would be ended if people just stopped talking. Verse 21. As charcoal to hot embers and wood to fire, so is a quarrelsome man for kindling strife. Figuratively, fuel keeps fire going. Very similar to verse 20. Fuel keeps fire going. If verse 20 uses the imagery of a fire dying out, verse 21 uses the imagery of a fire getting hotter. More wood, more charcoal keeps the fire going. So literally, contentious people keep problems going. You don't need to be an argumentative person to keep the fire going. You don't need to be, like, again, argumentative or feel like you're contentious. You could just be a curious person who won't let something drop. You keep pressing it and pressing it. And in the process, what are you doing? You're keeping the fire going. Don't blab about other people's problems. Verse 22, the words of a whisperer are like delicious morsels. By the way, we saw this exact verse a few weeks ago. We'll come back to that. The words of a whisperer are like delicious morsels. I say delicious morsels, and I just see chocolate chips, because we call them morsels, right? Chocolate morsels. And I don't know about you, I keep a bag in the freezer, and every once in a while, I just can't help it. I pull them out. They taste so good. I think that's part of the imagery of what's going on here in the text. Delicious morsels. They go down into the inner parts of the body. Verse 22 uses a different type of parallelism to add to the picture of a blabberer. Figuratively, delicious food slides down into the inner chamber of the body, like the deepest part of you loves good food. Literally, whispered words slide down into the inner chamber of your soul. Again, we talked about this in chapter 18, verse 8. Here's the point. Gossip, that blabbering, might seem pretty innocent, but it affects you, whether you know it or not, and it affects others. It feeds something deep inside of you. It feeds an emptiness within you that's not healthy. I think it's interesting that there's a word for all of this. You'll see a little picture book on the screen here. Anybody ever read those little Mr. Books and Miss Books years ago? Here's a good one to get. I've never actually seen the real copy of this. The word is Schadenfreude. Schadenfreude. Try that. Try saying that. Schadenfreude. Any German speakers out there? You can correct me later. I think Goldberg's might be in the second service to correct me. Schadenfreude. Schadenfreude literally means pleasure derived from observing someone else's misfortune. How about Mr. Schadenfreude? Mr. Schadenfreude takes pleasure in seeing the misfortune of people around him. How about that for a great little kid's book? Engaging in gossip and taking pleasure in someone else's misfortune reflects something of your own inadequacy or misfortune. Studies, actually, this is a construct that's been studied for a long time. Studies show that Schadenfreude is toxic. It kills friendships, it erodes trust, and it exacerbates your own depression. Remember we said last time when we talked about this? What's the solution? Stop it. Just stop it. Find a way to stop it. To blab about other people's problems is pathetic. If you're inclined to be a blabbermouth, take a look inside. Look deep inside and ask yourself, why in the world do I do this? What within you needs to find pleasure in perpetuating another person's problems with your words? Whether it's outright gossip or just pious concern, we talked about how, as you know, people of faith, we like to couch it in the language of, I just want to know how to pray. And I want everybody else to know how to pray too. Your inability to stop talking, here's the thing, your inability to stop talking might be the fuel that keeps the fire going. When we addressed the topic of gossip a few weeks ago, I proposed three questions. I'm going to reiterate them again. How do you know if you're engaging in gossip? Three questions. Is what I'm discussing true, kind, and necessary? Those three questions. Ask yourself those three questions. Is what I'm discussing true, kind, and necessary? If any of those three is missing, guess what? You're engaging in gossip. Let's draw this all together here. Wisdom prescribes extreme care in dealing with other people's problems. Wisdom prescribes extreme care in dealing with other people's problems. Three don'ts this morning. Don't meddle, don't trifle, don't blab. Don't meddle. Don't poke the bear unless you're ready for that bear to point its head right back at you. Don't trifle. Don't stir the pot, because by stirring the pot, you're causing problems for other people. Don't stir the pot unless you plan to stick around and be part of the solution. Number three, don't blab. Don't keep the fire going by making other people's problems the content of your conversations. It might seem that the wisdom of Proverbs prescribes just staying out of it, staying away. Like, just don't even go near other people's problems, which, by the way, would mean that you live all by yourself on an island with your problems. It's almost impossible to not get engaged in other people's problems. In many situations, though, it might be the wise thing to do just to say, I'm not going to get involved. But staying away is not always wise. Staying away, staying out of it, is not always best. The fuller picture of Scripture shows us what it looks like to deal with other people's problems in the right way. I think it's important for us to acknowledge that our Lord Jesus himself demonstrates what it looks like to genuinely, authentically, intentionally engage in people problems. Think about it. God in the gospel models for us how to get this right. What did he do? God, seeing the people problems, God bore the pain and the shame of suffering. Who was responsible? Whose suffering ought that to have been? That ought to have been ours. God doesn't meddle in the problem, No, God mediates the problem. God doesn't trifle with our issues. No, he enters into our issues. He stirs the pot and he triumphs for us in our problems. He doesn't blab, but he becomes one of us. He incarnates. He lives with us. He gets his hands dirty in our problems, not because there was something lacking within him, not because there was something deficient within him, but because of something deficient within us. He shows us what it looks like to enter into the problems of people seated next to you, people with whom you live, people who are all around you all day. He shows us how to do that by entering into our existence in the person of Jesus. Motivated, again, not by something that was lacking in him, but motivated in perhaps that characteristic that ought to drive all of us as we contemplate what it ought to look like to engage in other people's problems. What is it? Love. For God so loved the world. He didn't meddle, he mediated. He didn't trifle, but he triumphed. And he didn't blab, but he became one of us. Motivated by love. Benjamin Franklin, among all the inventions, you know, he was known as an inventor. He invented something called the busybody mirror, which I think this is a very curious little invention. The reason for the invention is probably a bit more like PG-13, so I'm just going to keep it basic here. Anyways, Benjamin Franklin invented the busybody mirror, a set of three mirrors hung from a window so that a person inside the building, could see who was out at the door in the front without being seen himself. So Franklin could see who was at the door outside his apartment, and particularly this was in France, when he was serving as a diplomat in France. He could see who was at the door without that person seeing that he was seeing him particularly or her. It was said that he used this even in the States whenever his mother-in-law came around. Anyways, whatever the reason was, Benjamin Franklin liked to use this little invention. Notice how necessity is the mother of invention. Anyways, he used this little invention so he could slip out the back door and truly not be at home. Whatever the reason, Franklin wanted to keep a watchful eye on everything that was going on around his little home. That's why it's called the busybody mirror. That's what a busybody does. A busybody is curious to know, reluctant to take responsibility, dodging real community, slipping out the back door when genuinely love is what is needed and required. Do you know that we have value statements here at our church? We have a value statement called authentic community. We have five value statements. They're not doctrinal statements. They're value statements. They kind of epitomize who we are and who we desire to become. Authentic community, we welcome each individual no matter the mess, no matter the brokenness. Think about it. To be a busybody, to meddle, to trifle, to blab, is the exact antithesis of what it is that we, by God's grace, want to become. By God's grace, we want to become people who genuinely, authentically engage in the people problems of people around us, but not motivated by curiosity alone, not motivated by the desire to stir the pot and walk away, but motivated by love, motivated by the desire to see everybody walking in wholeness, motivated to see everybody walking in maturity in Christ. Heavenly Father, thank you for the good pattern that we see in the gospel. And thank you, Father, for the gentle rebuke of the book of Proverbs. God, as we interact with complex people and their complex circumstances, give us wisdom to know how to do this in a way that honors wisdom, honors you, honors what we believe to be true about you. Thank you again, Father, for the incarnation that shows us how to do this right. We thank you for your great love, that you chose to poke the bear, even though that brought great suffering upon you yourself. You chose to get involved, to stir the pot, because you knew that there was no way out if you did not. Thank you, Father, for showing us how it's done. May we find ourselves living after that same model. In Jesus' name, amen.
Will you stand as we sing this blessing as we close our service this morning?
I just want to remind you, 2 weeks from today, as Gail noted before, we have Dr. Eli Haddad, who's going to be here with us. I've been drooling over this ministry in Lebanon for years, almost 20 years, so I am so proud of the fact that we get to have him here. Be praying for that weekend, and also come, invite a friend. I think this is one of the most exciting ministries that I know of, that I can think of. Full stop. So I'm so thrilled to have him visiting us on Sunday at the end of the month here, the 26th. Secondly, I can't remember what it was I was supposed to. Oh yes, after the second service, we have what we call Discover Skokie Valley. It's just a short time, 15 minutes or so, just to get to know you if you're here. If you haven't yet had the opportunity to connect, we'd love the opportunity to get to meet you. It's very informal. It's going to be down in the cafe area. Very special time to be able to get to know some of the folks that are newer to the church. So if you are newer, stick around for Sunday school. Come back for round two in our second service. We'd be glad to have you join us for that Discover Skokie Valley. Did I say Sunday school? We have Sunday school classes all over the building. If you need help finding a class, stop by the welcome desk, and we will make sure that we get you into a good class this morning. Why leave? I mean, it's snowing outside. You're going to slip. If you skip Sunday school, think of the possibility of slipping on the road. Wait till the snow stops. And don't just gather in the cafe and eat bagels. Bread of life before you get the bread of the bagel, you know, or eat them together, right? You can bring bagels to class, right, Stan? Okay. Let me read the benediction out of Hebrews. By the way, I see lots of college students. Welcome back, college students. Good to have you in the room today. Spring break. I hope you get lots of sleep. Hebrews chapter 13. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, may he equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you.